So we have seen how the iron is get absorbed, what is the iron metabolism, and what are the factors that increases and decreases the iron absorption as such. So let us have a look on the what are the causes for the iron absorption and iron deficiency anemia as such. So most importantly, it is the pregnancy and lactation, and even growing infants who are in need of iron. So if iron is not supplied in the adequate quantity, the amount is requirement is very, very high during pregnancy, during lactation, during infancy and childhood. So invariably they will end up with a iron deficiency anemia. So other causes are chronic blood loss like parasites, mainly it's a hookworm infestations, again common in developing countries, ulcers, duodenal ulcers, peptic ulcers, hernia patients, drugs like NSAIDs and so many things, carcinomas, especially carcinoma of the cecum, colitis, ulcerative colitis, diverticulosis, all of these can cause the chronic blood loss. So they say that it is a carcinoma of the cecum, which is a very important cause of the chronic blood loss anemia, that is iron deficiency anemia. So that has to be kept in mind. Malabsorption syndromes, mainly it may be due to the gastrectomy or sometimes duodenojejunostomy or even celiac disease, where you know main portion of the stomach is the one where iron is metabolized, mainly it's duodenum where it is absorbed, but gastric acidity is very important for the iron absorption. Poor diet is again very important cause in the developing countries like in India. So poverty, ignorance, population explosion, all of these are contributing factor for the iron deficiency anemias. So general signs and symptoms of anemia will be there. Patient will experience of fatigue, dyspnea and exertion, palpitations, pallor will be there, headache will be there, even dizziness, apathy, impaired attention, irritability. Patient will complain that he or she cannot remember whatever they have read for the exams. So it may be due to the iron deficiency anemias. Pica, so it's a very peculiar abnormal habit of eating materials like clay or even chalk pieces. So many things they keep on eating, even mud particles. So it's all known as pica, very specific for iron deficiency anemia. You have to look for the nail changes, so called as coilonychia. Initially it will start as a flatinychia, where you see flattened nail beds, and later on as the iron deficiency worsens, you will see spoon shaped deformity of the nails. We call it as coilonychia. So in severe iron deficiency anemia of long standing duration, you will see this very classically coilonychia. Tongue may show atrophic glossitis, mouth may show inflammation of the angles of mouth, we call it as angular cheilitis. There can be changes in hair, and even stomach will show gastric atrophy. There is a peculiar syndrome, very rare as such, but it's well established, known as Plummer-Vinson syndrome or a Patterson-Kelly syndrome, where there is a triad of iron deficiency anemia, atrophic glossitis and esophageal webs, post-cricoid web that is causing dysphagia. So once you remove this esophageal web, patient's dysphagia will disappear and naturally the other two causes will be cured. So what, as a pathologist or a hematologist, what we see, how to diagnose the iron deficiency anemia? Remember, hemoglobin should be reduced to call any case as anemia. So hemoglobin will be reduced. Let us have a look on this diagram, how iron deficiency may be detected under the iron emulsion field in the peripheral smears. So normal RBCs will have a central 1/3 as a pallor. The remaining is 2/3 is the hemoglobinized area. So only 1/3 central portion will be the pallor. We call these RBCs as normocytic, normochromic red blood cells. Why we are calling normocytic? Size will be normal. How to compare the size is normal? We have an internal control, the non-reactive small lymphocyte nucleus. So we will take only nucleus into account. We will not take cytoplasm into account. So we have one more cell, that is large granular lymphocyte, LGL. Remember, NK cell or a virocyte, that should not be taken into account. It is the non-reactive small lymphocyte. That the nucleus only you have to take, that act like an internal control in the peripheral blood, the size of which is said to be almost equal to that of a RBC size, diameter 7.2 microns. So if the size of RBC is same as that of a size of a nucleus of a small non-reactive lymphocyte, they are normocytic. Chromia, only 1/3 should be the pallor. If the chromia is less or pallor is more, then it is hypochromic RBC. So What will happen if the iron deficiency anemia is microcytic hypochromic anemia? So actually hypochromia starts first, that is followed by microcytes. So hypochromia is the first thing that indicates that patient is developing iron deficiency anemia. So see the RBC here, they are very very small. Compare the nucleus of a small non-reactive lymphocyte. So they are microcytic as well as para is increased, chromia is decreased. So microcytic hypochromic RBCs, right? So very classical shape of the RBCs, we call them as poikilocytes. So there is a variation in the size of RBCs, so we call it as anisocytosis, and we lose the word variation in the shape of the various shape of RBCs, poikilocytes. Very peculiar the shape is the pencil forms, and even teardrop forms can be seen in the iron deficiency anemias. Teardrop forms, in fact, it will be plenty in the case of the myelofibrosis. So pencil forms are very classical for the iron deficiency anemias. So remember, so these are the peripheral smear findings. Apart from that, there can be reactive thrombocytosis, especially if it is due to the blood loss anemia, then you will see iron deficiency anemia due to blood loss. So you will see reactive thrombocytosis, platelet count may be more. Remember, one platelet is equal to almost 20,000 platelet in Eilimerson field. So normal platelet count is around 1.5 lakhs to 4.5 lakhs. So more than 5.5 lakhs, say 6 lakhs, 7 lakhs, you will see in the iron deficiency anemia. So we call it as reactive thrombocytosis. If at all you start treatment for the iron deficiency anemia, say you supplement iron, then you will keep on seeing the polychromatophilic RBCs. What is this polychromatophilic RBC? Nothing but juvenile RBC. Juvenile RBC, where the new some amount of remnant of nucleus will be there. That's why you will see cytoplasm as if multicolored, mainly purple colored RBCs. They are quite larger in size, very large in size as compared to the normal RBCs. So these are polychromatophilic RBCs. Remember, they are also called as reticulocytes. So reticulocytes are nothing but polychromatophilic RBCs. They are nothing but juvenile RBCs. So to demonstrate reticulocytes, you need a special stain. What is that? Neomethylene blue. That is called as supravital stain. Why it is called as supravital? Because RBCs are stained live. How we will do supravital stain or reticulocyte stain? We will take 1 ml of blood, we will take 1 ml of dye, we will mix them together, incubate at 37 degrees centigrade for 15 minutes, then directly make a smear. So it is directly making the RBC stained live. So that's why we call it as supravital stain. So this is reticulocyte, nothing but polychromatophilic RBC. So it indicates that the bone marrow is responding by producing the red blood cells. So when you see more and more polychromatophils, so bone marrow is in a hurry to form the erythroid series. So you see polychromatophils only if there is you start treating for iron deficiency anemias. Otherwise bone marrow will not respond for that anemia. So these are very very important cells. Polychromatophilic cells are very important cell for diagnosing the yes hemolytic anemias. So there will be a reticulocytosis. Normal count is 0.5 to 2.5 maximum. So when you see more than 2.5% of reticulocytes, so reticulocytosis is classically seen in the hemolytic anemias. But even in iron deficiency anemia, once you start treating iron deficiency anemia with the hematinics, so you will see reticulocytosis. Understood. So these are the very classical findings. There will not be much finding in the WBCs. So RBC will be, as such RBC mass will be less, hemoglobin will be less, mean corpuscular volume. So let us have a look later on details. Mean corpuscular volume of the RBC will be less, mean corpuscular hemoglobin will be less, mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration will be less. So all the parameters are reduced in iron deficiency anemia, except it is TIBC, total iron binding capacity. So the RBCs are very hungry to eat the iron as such. So only parameter that is raised is the TIBC, and even serum ferritin levels will be less, serum iron levels will be less. So let us have a look what are the laboratory other findings. So remember, blood film will show microcytic hypochromic anemia, But remember, whenever you see microcytic hypercholic anemia, it is most of the time it is iron deficiency anemia, but you should also keep the other causes for the microcytic hypercholic anemia. You will see poikilocytes, mainly the pencil forms. You will see polychromatophilic RBCs once you start the treating the iron deficiency anemias. So red cell indices, all the indices are reduced, MCV reduced, MCHC reduced, MCH is reduced. Plasma iron or serum iron will be reduced less than, if it is severe form, less than 30 micrograms per deciliter. So normally 70 to 120. So increased TIBC levels. So total iron binding capacity is the only parameter that is increased in iron deficiency anemia. Remember this point, they will ask in the MCQs. Plasma bilirubin is normal. Why I am telling this is, in thalassemia also you will have the same, almost same type of picture. That is microcytic hypochromic anemia, but you see more number of target cells. So when you see RBCs with increased again hypochromic area, we call it as target cells. So something like this. So then it is target cell. So this is a case of hemolytic anemias. So target cells will be seen plenty in thalassemias, but otherwise it appears as a microcytic hypochromic anemia. Whenever you keep on seeing target cells in more quantity, then you should think that it is could be a case of thalassemia. So you have to correlate with the clinical findings like splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, and even joint disease will be there in patients with the thalassemias, but not in patients with the iron deficiency anemia. So iron deficiency anemia patients will have a normal plasma bilirubin levels. The marrow, actually it is not indicated. Bone marrow aspiration studies for diagnosing iron deficiency anemia is not indicated unless you wanted to know for a research purpose that there is no iron stores at all in the bone marrow. Otherwise, the marrow will show micronormoblastic erythroid hyperplasia as a response to anemia. So, ME ratio will become 1:1. Normal is 3:1. Myeloid will be more as compared to the erythroid. So, 3:15:1 is the normal ratio. So, here erythroid series will become more and more in response to anemia. And normoblast can even become micronormoblast. They can show ragged cytoplasmic edges. So, special stain you have to remember, Peierls Prussian blue stain for iron, that iron source will be totally get exhausted in the iron deficiency anemias. So remember this particular slide, you will have a MCQs on this, that all the parameters are reduced in the iron deficiency anemias, like MCV will be reduced, MCH will be reduced, MCHC will be reduced, hemoglobin will be reduced, red cell mass will be reduced, hematocrit, PCV is hematocrit, that will be reduced, bone marrow iron content will be reduced, sometimes it will be totally get exhausted. We actually grade the bone marrow iron 0, 1, 2, 3 like that, so it will be 0 in iron deficiency anemia. Serum iron levels, serum ferritin levels will be reduced. Only parameter that is raised is the TIBC, total iron binding capacity, more than 450 will be there. So bilirubin levels will be normal, whereas it will be raised in the hemolytic anemias, mainly thalassemias. Remember my friends, normal values you have to remember, especially the hematology parameters. So there is no excuse. In some of the entrances they will not give the normal values. So hemoglobin adult, you remember 15 plus or minus 2.5 gram percentage. In females 14 plus or minus 2.5 gram percentage. Hematocrit, what we call it as packed cell volume, in males it is around 45, 47 plus or minus 0.07. in females 42 plus or minus 0.05%. RBC count will be in millions, 5.5 plus or minus 1 in males, in females 4.8 plus or minus 1 millions per cubic mm. So MCHC is calculated by a formula like hemoglobin percentage divided by PCV, that is normally is around 30 to 36 gram per deciliter. MCH is hemoglobin per RBC, 26 to 34 picograms per liter, and it is expressed in the picograms. MCV is calculated by formula PCV divided by RBC, normally 76 to almost 96 femtoliter. So when we call microcytic RBC, it is less than 72 femtoliter. So 72 to 76 somewhere, it's a gray zone. So less than 72 MCV, 72 femtoliters, then we call the RBCs there as microcytic RBCs. And we also see macrocytes, we call them as when MCV value is more than 100. more than 100 femtoliters, so it is a macrocytic RBCs. So this is a classical blood picture appearance of the microcytic hypochromic anemia. So this is internal control, our small non-reactive lymphocytes. So compare it here with the RBCs. RBCs are appearing smaller than the nucleus of a small non-reactive lymphocyte. So they are smaller in size and there is a mild variation in the size and shape of the RBCs. So it is microcytic hypochromic RBCs. Yes, what is this? Pencil forms. Pencil forms are seen. Polychromatophilic RBCs are quite larger cells. These are polychromatophilic RBCs. So that indicates that patient is responding for the iron treatment, whatever you have given. So these are the platelets. So this is classical appearance of the microcytic hypochromic RBC will appear. So this is diagrammatical representation of the same. Normal RBC will have a central one-third pallor, whereas pallor is increased, chromia is reduced in the microcytic hypochromic RBCs. So one more picture, you compare again here. So these are polychromatophilic cells. So the one which are with the purple color, this is pencil forms, which are very classical for the iron deficiency anemias. So microcytic, so much microcytic. You see here, somewhere it is 56 or 60 femtoliters is the MCV value. So some amount of even macrocytes, if macrocytes are also seen, then it is a dimorphic anemia. Good number of 50% microcytes, 50% macrocytes, then it is dimorphic anemia, which is nutritional anemia, which is very, very common again in developing countries. So if at all you do the laboratory other investigations like serum iron estimation is and serum TIBC levels, serum ferritin levels, that estimation is much more important than the bone marrow estimation. So remember, bone marrow aspiration, bone marrow biopsy, I will not suggest if at all anybody want to carry it for iron deficiency anemia, because we have, it is an invasive and painful procedure, bone marrow examination. We have the simple serum estimation of iron, TIBC, ferritin, that is enough to diagnose as such the iron deficiency anemia. Only if you are interested in bone marrow iron content and you want to do pulse Prussian blue iron reaction, then only you can do the bone marrow aspiration studies. So TIBC levels will be raised. Normal levels is 253 to 435 micrograms per deciliter. This will be raised. Otherwise, serum iron, serum ferritin will be very, very much reduced. Serum iron will be as less as 30 micrograms per deciliter. Serum ferritin will be also reduced. So overall, you have to do the CBC, MCV, MCH, MCSC, and RDW. All those parameters are very, very important. Hemoglobin values, the PCB values, all those parameters are very important for a pathologist. Based on those parameters only, we diagnose most of these peripheral smears. So liver biopsy again to look for any extramedullary hematopoiesis or any other causes. So remember, my friends, bone marrow examination is not really required to diagnose iron deficiency anemia. It is only indicated for evaluation of the bone marrow iron content by Pearl's iron stain. Totally the stores will be nil in cases of iron deficiency anemia. Whereas if you want to differentiate microcytic hypochromic blood picture from thalassemia picture, then again bone marrow examination is very crucial, very important. There in thalassemia patients, there will be a hemochromatosis, there will be excessive iron stores. So if you are suspecting thalassemia, then and if you want to know that bone marrow iron content is reduced or more, then yes, then it is very much indicated. So for that, you have to also evaluate clinically if the patient is having jaundice, hepatomegaly, splenomegaly, and there will be other findings of thalassemia like frontal bossing, bone marrow expansion. Then you can think about the bone marrow studies. What it will show, bone marrow in iron deficiency anemia, it shows erythroid hyperplasia as a response to the peripheral anemia. The erythroid series will mature more and more. They will mature and differentiate. But for classic maturation will not take place. These normoblasts are so called as micronormoblastic. Again, they are very smaller in size. Normoblast, but normally reduced in size. So we call it as micronormoblastic erythroid hyperplasia. Yes. With that, let us have a look, a small brief on the introduction, that is treatment of the anemia. So what is most important is you have to correct the underlying cause. For example, if the patient is in carcinoma sequum and you keep on treating with iron tablets, it is of no use. So resect the tumor, iron deficiency anemia will totally disappear by itself. So correct the underlying cause and raise the hemoglobin to the normal percentage. But don't expect that the hemoglobin will be raised within no time. So today you start treatment and tomorrow don't think hemoglobin will become normal. So it is very gradually it increases. So expected level of raise in hemoglobin is say 0.1 to 0.2 grams per day itself with a hematinic treatment. So if you start a hemoglobin treatments today with the hematinics, so as for peripheral repeat blood CBCs and peripheral smear interpretation at least at an interval of around 7 to 10 days, then only you may see 1 gram or 2 grams hemoglobin is raised. So not every day, it is not required. Most important, again, you have to prevent the recurrence of the anemias. We have a national nutritional anemia prophylaxis program where the pregnant woman as well as the children's will be supplemented with 100 milligram of iron plus 50 micrograms of folic acid to the pregnant woman, whereas 20 milligram of iron and 100 micrograms of folic acid to the children. So this is the one which is established in 1992, and that is again to prevent the iron deficiency anemia in the mass community. As such, blood transfusion is not the treatment of choice for iron deficiency anemia. So better is hematinics. You have to stimulate the bone marrow. You have to make the bone marrow to synthesize more and more RBCs as such. So only if the patient is having very, very severe anemia, like hemoglobin is somewhere around 2 to 3 and going for congestive cardiac failure, yes, that time you can think about blood transfusion, not whole blood transfusion, it is RBC concentrate. Why you should give unnecessarily the WBCs and platelets? Platelets, of course, in fact, it will be raised. There will be a reactive thrombocytosis. So don't infuse platelets. There is no need of infusing the WBCs. So give only RBC concentrate. Now we have the component separation therapy. So give only RBC rich concentrate to the patient with the iron deficiency anemia. So that can be taken into account if there is a severe anemia, hemoglobin level less than 6 or 7, you can think about it. But hematinics is the best. You will make the bone marrow to respond by producing more and more RBCs as such. So with that, we'll have a look on the other types of anemias. Thank you.